Hi everyone, Rabbi David Tawil here from Mishna Study, Masichet Shevuot, Perek He, Mishna Gimel. Mishna Gimel is going to sound very similar to Mishnayot that we've done in the past, talking about situations where the language of the Shevuah, of the oath, is going to determine if a person is liable for one Shevuah or if a person is liable for multiple Shevuot, depending on how the dialogue takes place, what verbiage is used, and what the intention of the person taking the Shevuah is. So let's read several cases over here and discuss the different mahlokot about when a person is hayav ahat, when they're only liable for one shivuat pikadon, versus when they are liable for multiple shivuat pikadon. The Mishnah begins, hayu hamisha tuv'in oto. There were five people, all of whom were claiming something against him. So you have five people together saying that a particular individual has their possessions in his property. Amrulo, and they said to him, ten nano pikadon shiesh nano biadecha, give us back the deposit that is in your possession that belongs to us. Shivua she'en lachem biadi, to which the defendant responds, I swear, I take an oath that I do not have any of your possessions in my hands. Eno hayav ela ahat. In such a situation, he'd only be liable for one shivuat pikadon if he swore falsely, because the language here is such that he is taking on all five of them at once, and all of them are being tovea him at once. Therefore, his one shivuah is really one oath that encompasses all five of them, and therefore is only liable for one if he swore falsely. However, shivuah she'en lecha biyadi ve'lo lecha ve'lo lecha. However, if in his response back, the one who was being accused of having their possessions in his property says to them, I take an oath she'en lecha biyadi, that I don't have any of your stuff in my possession, or your stuff in my possession, or your stuff in my possession, meaning that he separated each person who was being tovea him, rather than in the first case, grouping them all together, hayav al kol ahat ve'ehat. He is therefore liable for each and every individual oath. In other words, each and every person that he separated, it was his intention, apparently, to take upon himself a separate oath for each person who was being tovea him. And therefore, if each one of them is false, or however many of them are false, he's going to be liable for each one individually. Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Shimon, two Tanaim here, come and debate Tanakama on a few nuanced principles in the verbiage. Rabbi Eliezer says he cannot be liable for each and every one of them as a separate oath, ad shiyomar shivu'a ba'aharona, until he says that it is a swear at the end, until he puts the shivu'a at the end. In other words, Rabbi Eliezer comes from a technicality and says, if he says, Shivua she'en lecha biyadi, right? If he says, I take a swear that I don't have any of your possessions, and then he just adds in, velo lecha, velo lecha, velo lecha, according to Rabbi Eliezer, he's not going to be hayav for each one individually because he put the word Shivua at the beginning. And therefore, the Shivua can only be hal on the first one of them. The fact that he adds in, velo lecha, velo lecha, is going to be grouped in as part of the same oath, because he said the word shivua at the beginning. Ledaat Rabbi Eliezer, the person is only going to be liable for each one individually if he puts shivua ba'aharona, if he puts the language of shivua at the end. So for example, as Rabbi Ovadia says, he says, en lecha biyadi, I don't have any of your possessions, velo lecha, velo lecha, bishvua, and I take an oath on each one of them. Then says Rabbi Eliezer, by putting shivua at the end, retroactively he separated each one, and as a result, each one is its own oath. But if he did shivua in the beginning, as Tanakama put it, it would not be hayav al kol ahad ve'ehad. That's Rabbi Eliezer's position. Rabbi Shimon also comes from a nuance, and he disagrees with all of them and says, Rabbi Shimon says, ad shiomar shivua lechol ehad ve'ehad, until he says the language of shivua for each and every oath. In other words, Rabbi Shimon disagrees both with Tanakama, who puts Shivua at the beginning to cover all of them, each one individually, and Rabbi Eliezer, who puts Shivua at the end to separate each one individually. Lefi Rabbi Shimon is the most mekel of all of them and says the only way you have a separate Shivua for each one of them individually is if he reiterates the language of Shivua for each and every person separately. However, if he uses one language of Shivua, whether at the beginning or at the end, to cover all five, he's not going to be hayav al kol ahad ve'ahad. He's only going to be hayav, one punishment, one korban Hashem, for all of them together. So we have three-way mahloket, Tanakama, Rabbi Eliezer, Rabbi Shimon, how we go about analyzing the words of the defendant in his Shivua when he's being nitba from five different people to determine if he's hayav ahad or if he's hayav for each and every one individually. Tanakama, I guess you can call him the most strict in the sense that he's going to allow them to be separated as Shavuot much more easily. Rabbi Eliezer is a little bit more lenient than him by saying it has to be Shavuot Ba'acharonah to separate them. And Rabbi Shimon is the most lenient in saying it's not separated until you use a separate language of Shavuot for each and every one of them. Rabbeinu Ovadia Mibar Tenura, as well as the Rambam, both say, En halacha lo k'Rabbi Eliezer ve lo k'Rabbi Shimon. The halacha does not follow Rabbi Eliezer or like Rabbi Shimon in this situation. The halacha follows Tanakamma. That is the first part of Mishnah Gimel. The second part of Mishnah Gimel talks about a new case in which a person is being charged, not by five different people, by the same person, but for multiple multiple types of theft, multiple types of possession in which he has of someone else's money. Let's take a look at that case. Ten li pikadon utzumet yad gezel va'aveda sheyesh li biyadicha. A person approaches another individual and says, give me back the pikadon, the deposit, utsumet yad, and the money which you took from me, gezel, the money which you stole from me, va'aveda, and the money which you found, which belongs to me. In other words, different types of monies that might be in the person's possession that he received in different manners. And now he's coming and saying, you have all these different types of my possession in your property. So now I want them all back. If the person responds shivua she'en lecha biyadi, if he responds wholeheartedly in one sentence, I take an oath that I don't have anything of yours in my hand, eno hayav ela ahat, he's only liable for one shivuat pikadon if he swore falsely. We don't look at the fact that the plaintiff accused him of having different types of monies in his possession as being separate oaths. He's taking one oath on all of them that he doesn't own anything of the other person's money. However, again, if he separates them, shivua she'en lecha biyadi, if he says, I take an oath that I don't have in my possession, pikadon, he reiterates, a loan, a deposit, utsumet yad, a loan, vegezel, and theft, the aveda, or a lost object. So he reiterates each of them, which the plaintiff claimed against him, and he reiterates each one of them individually with an oath. Hayav al kol ahad ve'ehad. Then he's liable for each and every one of them individually because the fact that he separated them and delineated them the way that the accuser did, it's a mashma that he wants to take an oath on each and every one of those to validate his claim. And therefore, whichever ones or all of them that are found to be false, he's going to be hayav a korban for each and every one of them. That's case number two here in the Mishnah. Case number three discusses another nuance, another detail of this, in which a person is talked about different types of grain. Ten li hitim us'orim ve'kusmim sheyesh li biyadecha. The plaintiff comes and says, give me the wheat, barley, and spelt sheyesh li biyadecha, that belongs to me, that you have in your possession. Now notice he said three different types of grains. Shivua she'en be'echa biyadi, once again, if the defendant says, I take an oath that I don't have any of these in my possession, eno hayav ela ahad, he's only liable for one of them because he grouped them all together. He's saying, I don't have anything in my possession, just like we saw in the previous case when it talked about the different types of money. Shivua she'en lecha biyadi hitin us'arim v'kusmim. If he takes an oath and he specifies each one individually, I don't have the hitim, the wheat, or the sa'orim, or the barley, or the spelt. But the fact that he reiterated each one individually, mashma, he wants to take an oath on each one, hayav al kol ahad ve'ehad, he's liable for each one individually. This seems to be exactly like the previous case, which is why one questions at this stage of the game why the Mishnah needs to reiterate this case. The reason why is for Rabbi Meir. Rabbi Meir comes and debates this and says there's even a nuance within this that could be hayav al kol ahad ve'ahad against the hachamim. Rabbi Meir says, afilu amar hita, even if he said hita in a singular language. Notice how the case of Tanakama was hitin in the plural and se'orim in the plural. Says Rabbi Meir, even if the guy says en li biyadi, en lecha biyadi hita in the singular, us'ora, in the singular, barley in the singular, v'kusemet, and spelt in the singular, hayav al kol ahad ve'ehad, he's liable for each one of them individually. What is the crux of this debate between Tanakama and Rabbi Meir? The crux is, what is the language of plural versus singular? What does it connote? If you look at Rabbeinu Ovadia Mibar Teuna, he says, the savar Rabbi Meir is of the opinion, hato'enet havero hita, somebody who claims against his friend and uses the singular language hita, What he's talking about is min hita ka'aman. He's talking about the species of wheat. He's not talking about an individual wheat kernel, one of them, and that's why he used the singular language. Sometimes in language, you can have something in the singular form, which actually has the connotation of plural. So for example, in English, we say deer. Well, the word deer can sometimes refer to one deer, or it could say there's deer over there. And the same word has the connotation of many, many deer, right? And so over here as well, by saying hita, Rabbi Meir says, he's not talking about one hita grain. He's talking about all the hita that a person might have, and he calls it in the singular language. So to barley and spelt could be phrased in the singular and referring to the species as a whole. As the Pasuk says, this is talking about in the Makkah of Barad, in Sefer Shemot Perek Tet, when it talks about what the barad, the hail in Mitzrayim, what it destroyed. The Pasuk tells us that the hita and the kusemet, the wheat and the spelt, lo nuku, they were not destroyed because afilot hinna, because they are late to rise. It wasn't the season that they had risen out of the ground, and as a result, they weren't destroyed by the barad. Notice in the Pasuk, it calls the wheat, talking about the entire wheat crop, and the kusemet, the entire spelt crop, in a singular language. And so Rabbi Meir draws support from that Pasuk to say that you could use the word hita, seora, and kusemet in singular, and it's a reference to the entire species, and therefore that would also be liable al kulahat ve'ahat if the person took an oath in such a manner. That being said, Rabbanan Savre, the Hachamim disagree, and notice how they only had it in the plural form, and they say, we don't necessarily apply the language of the Torah to the language of human beings. He says, in the language of human beings, it would need to be specified in the plural. We're very meticulous in order to connote the idea of many hita, or the idea that we're talking about a species as a whole. And therefore, Rabbanan Savre, gargir ehad shel hita v'shel seora v'shel kusemet ka'amar. Using the singular means you're talking about a singular grain of wheat, barley, or spelt, and as a result, you're not grouping them in species, separating them as an oath. Rather, he's talking about a specific grain of hita, seora, and kusemet, and therefore that's roping them all together. And therefore, according to Hachamim, he would still be hayav only ahat, not a separate shivuah for each and every one of them. The Rabbi Meir says, "En halacha ke Rabbi Meir." We do not hold like Rabbi Meir over here. We are more meticulous like the Hachamim to be more lenient, that one would not be required ahat ve'ahat. He would not be required a separate korban if he mentioned it in the singular.